Harper Audio presents The Map of True Places by Brunonia Barry, performed by Alyssa Bresnahan. Copyright 2010 by Brunonia Barry. Production copyright 2010 by HarperCollins Publishers. It is not down in any map. True places never are. Herman Melville. Prologue. In the years when her middle name was trouble, Z had a habit of stealing boats. Her father never suspected her of any wrongdoing. He let her run free in those early days after her mother's death. He was busy being a pirate reenactor. An odd leap for a man who'd been a literary scholar all his life. But those were desperate times, and they were both weary from constantly carrying their loss, unable to put it down except in those brief moments when they could throw themselves into something beyond the reach of their memories. In her fantasy world, the one where she could forgive herself for what happened that year, Z liked to think that her father, Finch, would have been proud of her skills as a thief. In her wildest dreams, she pictured him joining her adventure. A huge leap for the professor, but not for the pirate he was quickly becoming. She had a preference for speedboats. Anything that could do over 30 knots was fair game. There was little security back then, and most of the keys, if there were any, were hidden somewhere on the boats themselves, usually in the most obvious place imaginable. The game was simple. She would pick a boat that looked fast and sleek, give herself exactly 5 minutes to break in and get the engine started, and head out of the harbor toward the ocean. Once she passed the confines of Salem, she would open up the engine and point the bow straight out toward Baker's Island. Later that night, she would return the stolen boat. There was only one rule. She could never return a boat to the same mooring from which she had stolen it. It was a good rule, not just because it presented an additional challenge, but also because it was practical. If she put the boat back on the same mooring, she would be much more likely to get caught. Everyone knows that the last thing any good thief should do is revisit the scene of the crime. Usually, Z would abandon the boat at one of the public docks that line Salem's waterfront. Often, it was the one at the Willows, the first dock you came to when you entered the harbor. But when the cops started looking for her, she began to leave the boats in other, less obvious places. Sometimes she would jump someone else's mooring, or she would leave a boat in one of the slips at Derby Wharf, which made it easy to get away, since she lived so close. Only one time did she mess up and misjudge the fuel level. She was all the way up by Singing Beach in Manchester when the engine died. At first, she didn't believe she had run out of gas. But when she checked the fuel again, her mistake was clear. Fighting the panic that was beginning to overtake her, she tried to come up with a plan. She could easily swim to shore, but if she did, the boat would either drift out to sea or smash against the rocks. For the first time, she was afraid of getting caught. In a strange way, she was grateful that there were no other boats around, no one she could signal for help. Not knowing what else to do, she let the boat drift. She looked up at the moonless sky, the stars brighter than she had ever seen them, their reflections dissolving in the water around her like an effervescent medicine that seemed to dissolve her panic as well. Here, floating along with the current, staring up at the heavens, she knew that everything would be all right. When she looked back down at the horizon to get her bearings, she found she had drifted toward shore. A dark outline of something appeared in her peripheral vision, and, when she turned to face it, a dock came into focus, and on the hill beyond it, a darkened house. She grabbed an oar and began to steer the boat in toward shore, catching the onsweep of tide that propelled it broadside toward the dock. She grabbed the bow line and jumped, slipping and twisting her ankle a little, but keeping the boat from colliding with the dock. She tied up, securing bow and stern, and scrambled over the rocks to the beach. Then she made her way up the road toward the train station, limping a bit from her aching ankle, but not really too bad, all things considered. Z wanted to take the train back to Salem, but it was past midnight, and the trains had stopped running. She thought about sleeping on the beach. It was a warm night. She would have been safe. But she didn't want to concern her father, who had enough to worry about these days. And she didn't want to be anywhere in the vicinity of Manchester when they found the stolen boat. So she ended up hitchhiking back to Salem. Not a smart thing to do, she thought, as she walked to the Chevy Nova that had stopped about 50 feet ahead of her and was frantically backing up. It was a woman who picked her up, probably mid-40s, slightly overweight, with long hair and blue eyes that glowed with the light of passing cars. At first, the woman said she was only going as far as Beverly, but then she changed her mind and decided to take Z all the way home, because if she didn't, she was afraid that Z would start hitchhiking again and might be picked up by a murderer or a rapist. As they rode down Route 127, the woman told Z every horror story she had ever heard about hitchhiking, and then made Z give her word never to do it again. Z promised, just to shut her up. "That's what all the kids say, but they do it anyway," the woman said. Z wanted to tell her that she never hitched, that she wasn't the victim type, and that she had only thumbed a ride tonight to cover a crime she'd committed. Grand theft, boto. But she didn't know what other cautionary tales such a confession might unleash, so she kept her mouth shut. As she was getting out of the car, Z turned back to the woman. Instead of saying thank you, she said in a voice that was straight out of a Saturday morning cartoon show she'd watched when she was a little girl, "Will you be my mommy?" She had meant it as a joke, but the woman broke down. She just started crying and wouldn't stop. Z told the woman that she was kidding. She had her own mother, she said, even though it wasn't true. Not anymore. Nothing she could say would stop the woman's tears, and so finally she said what she should have said all along. "Thank you for the ride." Of course, Z hadn't given the woman her real address. She didn't want her getting any ideas, like maybe going into the house and having a word with Finch. She had planned to hide in the shadows until the woman drove away and then cut through the neighboring yards to get home. But in the end, she just walked straight down the road. The woman was crying too hard to notice where Z went or how she got there. 10 years later, as Z was training to become a psychotherapist, having outgrown the middle name Trouble, she saw the woman again in one of the panic groups run by her mentor, Dr. Liz Mattei. The woman didn't remember her, but Z would have known her anywhere. Those same translucent blue eyes, still teary. The woman had lost a child, a teenager, and a runaway, she said. Her daughter had been diagnosed as bipolar, like Z's mother, Maureen, but had refused to keep taking lithium because it made her fat. She'd been last seen hitchhiking on Route 95, heading south, holding a hand-lettered sign that read, "New York." It was the winter of 2001, and 10 years since the woman had lost her daughter. The Twin Towers had recently come down. The panic group had grown in size, but its original members had become oddly more calm and helpful to each other, as if their free-floating anxiety had finally taken form, and the rest of the country had begun to feel the kind of terror they'd felt every day for years. For the first time Z could remember, people in the group actually looked at each other, and when the woman talked about her daughter, as she had every week they'd been meeting, the group finally heard her. "The world can change, just like that," the woman said. "In the blink of an eye," someone answered. Tissues were passed, and the group cried together for the first time, crying for the girl and for her inevitable loss of innocence, and, of course, for their own. Bipolar disorder had recently become a catch-all diagnosis. While it had once been believed that the condition occurred after the onset of puberty, as it had with this woman's daughter, now children were being diagnosed as early as 3 years of age. Z didn't know what she thought about that. As with many things lately, she was of two minds about it. She hadn't realized her joke until Mattei pointed it out, thinking it was intentional. No, Z had told her. She was serious. Certainly it was a disease that needed treatment. Untreated bipolar disorder seldom led to anything but devastation. But medicating too early seemed wrong. Something more in line with insurance and drug company agendas than with the kind of help Z had trained for years to provide. The world-famous Dr. Mattei had long since abandoned her panic group, leaving them for Z or one of the other psychologists to oversee. Mattei had moved on to her latest best-selling book idea, which proposed the theory that the daughter will always live out the unfulfilled dreams of the mother. Even if she doesn't know what those dreams are, even if those dreams have never been expressed, this will happen, according to Mattei, with alarming regularity. It wasn't a new idea, but it was Mattei's theory that this was more likely to happen if those dreams were never expressed, in much the same way that those who cannot remember the past are condemned to repeat it. Z had often wondered about the woman with the translucent eyes who came back to the panic group only once after that evening. She wondered about her unfulfilled dreams, expressed or unexpressed, and she wondered if there was something that her daughter was acting out for her mother, as she herself had stood on Route 95 and accepted a ride from a stranger heading south. Z was glad that the woman had left the group before Mattei had brought up her latest theory. The mother blamed herself enough for her daughter's disappearance, wondering every day if she might have changed the course of events if only she'd given her daughter that one elusive thing she'd failed to provide, something tangible and even ordinary, perhaps, like that red dress in Filene's window, or the week away at Girl Scout camp that her daughter had begged for years ago. No one understood the concept of if only better than Z. She lived it every day, though she didn't have to search to find the elusive thing. She thought she knew what her mother had wanted that day so many years ago, what might have helped lift her out of her depression. It was a book of Yeats' poetry given to Maureen by Finch on their wedding day, and it was one of her mother's treasures. Z's if only had worked in reverse. If only she hadn't gotten her mother what she wanted that day. If only she hadn't left her alone. Z might have been able to save her. Part 1. May, 2008. Method of keeping a ship's reckoning. A ship's reckoning is that account by which it can be known at any time where the ship is and on what course or courses she must steer to gain her port. Nathaniel Bowditch, The American Practical Navigator. Chapter 1. Lily Braden was late. Mattei poked her head through Z's door. "It's so damned hot out there," she said. "Oh, God, you're not in session, are you?" "I'm supposed to be," Z said, looking at the clock. It was 3:15. Mattei was redressing as she spoke, kicking off running shoes and pulling on her suit jacket. She walked 5 miles along the Charles River every afternoon, weather notwithstanding. When she was overbooked, which was a good deal of the time, she had been known to conduct her sessions while strolling along the river, calling it a walking meditation, telling patients it would be easier to open up if they didn't feel her prying eyes on them. A week after she started conducting sessions that way, every shrink in Boston was out walking with patients. "God, not that agoraphobic again." It was another of Mattei's jokes. 50% of their patients had some degree of agoraphobia, a phenomenon that made attendance poor at best, and had lately prompted Mattei to start charging time and a half for missed appointments, though Z seldom required her patients to comply with this new rule. Mattei was trying harder than usual to make her laugh today, meaning that Z must be frowning again. Z's natural expression seemed to be the type of frown that inspired joke-telling, often from total strangers, who always felt compelled to make her feel better somehow. Just this morning, an older gentleman who had neglected to pick up his dog's poop in Lewisburg Square had walked over to her and ordered her to smile. She stared at him. "Things can't be all that bad."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.